Yeah. Yes, good morning, everybody. We would like to start our session. Welcome to this session, Crossing Cultures and Nations, Interculturality and Transnational Mobility as Challenge of Sport and Sport Science. Chaired by Åge Rattman from the University of Malmö in Sweden and myself, Petra Gieß-Stüber from Freiburg in Germany. As in all sessions, I ask you to switch off your mobiles. We are expecting two very promising presentations. After every presentation, you may ask your questions. We have two microphones for the audience. The first presentation focuses one key issue of the 21st century. Given the process of pluralization that resulted from internationalization, the religious, cultural, and ethnic culturality of heterogeneity of our societies will increase, as will contacts between people of differing cultural values and norms in sports and beyond of it. When we look at the discourse about integration and interculturality in sports and even in sports sciences, we have to state that the principle of hope is still dominating facts. Evidence-based interventions are needed if we really want to contribute to build inclusive and peaceful societies through sports and with help of sports. Thank you very much, Ulrich. Professor Elke Grimminger takes up this challenge and promises to give an overview of theoretical foundations and empirical issues. I'm especially delighted and proud to introduce this speaker because I had the chance and joy to work together with her during her academic qualification at the University in Freiburg. After 3 years as junior professor in Hamburg, Elke is working actually at the Technical University in Dortmund. As you may know, Dortmund is one of the hosting institutions of the ECSS Congress in 2017, so you will meet her in the next year as member of the scientific committee. Particular areas of her research are intercultural competences among PE teachers, education research, focusing peer relations in physical education and health education issues. Since several years, Elke is an active member of a French research group, Équipe de Recherche en Sciences Sociales du Sport, at the University of Strasbourg. Now I want to give the floor to my esteemed colleague, Elke Grimminger.
Thank you very much, Petra, for that nice warm welcome. Just to know, Petra is my PhD supervisor, and I'm also very happy that she's chairing me in this session. But first of all, dear Congress Presidents, dear ECSS Board, dear colleagues, I'm really very happy to give you this talk about such a current topic, and it's quite an honor for me. I have a big challenge to give you in 30 minutes an overview about a really social challenging topic like interculturality in sports. And I will try to give you a short overview of the theoretical foundations to try to define what is meant by interculturality. And afterwards, I will give you a short overview of selected empirical results to tell you what can sport contribute to social integration processes in sport and also in society. Crossing borders through sport sciences is the slogan of the current conference. However, crossing borders has to become more significant for other people because crossing border is the guiding idea of many people displaced by war, conflict, or persecution. The number of refugees has increased significantly and consistently over the past 4 years. In the year 2014, the UN Refugee Agency counted almost 60 million of refugees worldwide. And you may imagine that it's almost the conflict or the war in Syria that is the most biggest producer of refugees inside a country and outside of the country. As a result of migration, most Western industrial nations evolved into heterogeneous societies, heterogeneous in the meaning of socially, linguistically, ethnically, and culturally different. So living peaceful in a heterogeneous society needs intercultural dialogue that is based on mutual respect. In this area, a range of fields of action have been identified which can help to promote intercultural understanding or intercultural dialogue. And sport is one such area of activity, and it's often considered as a key motor of promoting integration processes. Claims are often made that sport has a significant potential for social inclusion, and that claims are certainly pertinent to the situation of refugees and asylum seekers and come nowadays once again in the discussion. The claims range from individual benefits for the refugees, for the asylum seekers, for the migrants, as sport can help them to deal better with stress, to get healthier. But they range also from social benefits like fighting social isolation, building social networks, and also from communal or societal issues like fighting against discrimination or fighting against criminal incidents. Sport is lived integration, is often cited by policy or sport federal agents. However, we have to look beside these political hope and probably merchandising perspectives. Sport can have a potential of integration, but the reality shows that sport is also in context where discrimination and xenophobia and racism occur. For example, black footballers are confronted in stadiums with ape screams and bananas, as, for example, Kevin Prince Boateng. After such an experience, being welcomed by ape screams in a football stadium, Boateng was invited to speak at the UN Nations. And he said, "At the beginning, I tried to ignore racism like a nasty headache. But that's an illusion. Racism won't disappear. Racism is like malaria. A vaccination against it is not enough. You need to drain the ponds where the mosquito grow." Though we have to look very closely and differentiatedly on what can sport contribute to integration processes in sport and also in society. And we have to see, is it probably an ambivalent or ambiguous pair, the two of both sport and integration? We have many studies that have shown that finally sport attracts more people with different backgrounds than other voluntary institutions or organizations. Also, sport is one of the most popular free time activities, especially for youngsters, for children and youth. And we can see in some different studies that migrants who do sports in sports clubs have more contacts or interactions with national peers than those migrants who are not involved in a sport club, that we often call they are socially integrated, and being socially integrated can be a motive for other integration processes, for example, in academic positions in societies. However, we can see there are other studies in contrast and showing that sport has exclusion potential too. We can see in a lot of studies that especially girls and women with migration background and or with less socioeconomic background are still underrepresented in sport clubs. Often in theory and from a theoretical point of view, sport is often considered as a predestinated field of enhancing intercultural competence, of promoting intercultural dialogue, because in sport you can combine motor, social, cognitive and emotional aspects. What is needed for intercultural learning, and there are some studies in educational science that strengthen intercultural learning cannot happen only on a cognitive way, but needs to combine with social and emotional aspects. However, we have only less studies about intercultural learning and integration processes in sport that really show a constructive dealing with diversity or integration processes, that integration and handling diversity constructively does not happen per se. The less studies that are about researching about obstacles and requirements for integration processes in sports show we have or we need special requirements if we would like to promote successful integration processes in sport. So we have to look, is sport really a predestinated field for integration processes? As we can see, that finally, sporting activities are not per se integrative. Finally, the conditions, the prerequisites, define the integrative power of sport offers or sporting activities. In some studies, or to conclude, Buhrmann concluded that finally the empirical studies about integration processes in sport show that the integration of potential of sport is finally just a bold and simple hope if the social inequality that exists per se in culturally heterogeneous groups is not discussed and is not perceived and is not accepted and respected. Finally, we need to promote successfully integration processes in sport. We need particular concepts, for example, a pedagogical concept that help to handle diversity and social inequality constructively. And in this discussion, often the term interculturality occurs, and interculturality is at one hand a pedagogical concept often used in educational science for promoting intercultural learning, and in sociology, for example, for sport organization, it can be used as a descriptive quality marker. So if sport clubs decide to promote integration processes, they need a concept that means lived interculturality, that means implementing constructive and universal rules for participation in their sport organization. And that's why that interculturality is more than integration. Because integration in its term itself means that a homogeneous system exists in which others will be integrated. Though the blue one are the hosting society, and it is suggested that they're homogeneous, but they are not. If I tell you that all Austrian Germans, people from UK are the same, are homogeneous in their culture, in their language, they would, all of you would say no. Especially in Germany, they would say no. However, and although also the green one that have to be integrated, they are not homogeneous neither. So you have people, you have refugee, asylum seekers, other established ethnic minorities like people migrating due to academic context, though they are not homogeneous. But in a sense of integration, integration means a desired outcome of an official policy. For example, participating in a sport offer is already a successful integration if, for example, migrants attend sport offers. On the other hand, or in contrast, interculturality, if we take it serious as a quality marker, this concept has an emancipatory and normative approach, by creating equality, by fighting against social hierarchies. So by taking into account social inequality and trying to fight against these hierarchies. Not neglecting hierarchies, but taking them as challenge. Inequality, interculturality means, in this sense, for example, that all persons, regardless of their social cultural background, participate equally, for example, in decision processes in sport organizations. And it means also that particular interests, for example, of Muslim girls and women, are respected, and that particular sport offers with a female, probably Muslim coach, are offered. And this will be my argumentation for the next following minutes. Lived interculturality is, in that kind, more than integrating people and make people participating in sport offers. For sport clubs, it means to be open and willing to change. And that's really a big challenge for sport providers. They need to be, have to be willing to integrate all people equally at all decision and organization levels. That means, for example, by acknowledging particular interests, for example, giving resources like gyms, coaches, time space for female separated offers, and by making participate persons with migration background at all levels. This means also on the management level, as well as on the executive level, for example, make them decide financial decisions. And the sport providers must take into account that they need continuous formations in intercultural competencies for all responsible persons on the executive, on the decision or organization level. In the following minutes, I will give you, these were the theoretical foundations, a short theoretical overview of the theoretical foundations, and I will give you now an overview of the empirical results. Are sport providers prepared to live that kind of interculturality, that kind of quality marker? But however, presenting results about integration and interculturality in sport is not able to, if there is not a decision or reflection about the national context policy. So, before I can start with the empirical results, just a short view about the national sport policies in the European countries. In 2006, Henry analyzed the different models of integration in sport in the European countries. And as you can see, this survey or this study is already 10 years old, because you can see Greece has been identified as a homogeneous society. And I would think that Greece isn't anymore a homogeneous society by coming all that people or crossing all that people to crossing borders to Greece. However, the first group of countries that Henry identified are countries like Belgium, Finland, and the United Kingdom. They have culturally diverse populations and have embraced actively, at least in terms of political rhetorics, multicultural, intercultural policies. The second group of countries, which includes Germany, Austria, and for example France, have culturally diverse populations, but they have a history of largely assimilationist thinking. This means they had the aim to save the existing system and asking the others, so you remember the green one, to adapt to the existing system. For Germany, we can see that the national sport policy is moving up to the concept of interculturalism, and particular interests of minorities are considered, are respected. Whereas in France, for example, the principle of everyone or all are equal counteracts these particularities. However, France too was in 2006 on the way of an interculturalistic concept. In the year of 2006, the third group of countries were culturally heterogeneous, culturally homogeneous, and they have already adopted assimilist policies in sport for ethnic minorities. And finally, the fourth group, they are either, for example, Malta, Cyprus, and Slovenia. They have been in 2006 relatively homogeneous, and the other countries like Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, or Slovakia, they have been in the year of 2006 relatively heterogeneous, but they had shown any intervention or interest in relation to sports policy for ethnic minorities. To conclude, talking about integration and interculturality in sport is not possible without reflecting own cultural classes, and that means reflecting my own German cultural classes. And also cannot present empirical data about all around the world and internationally valid, because you have also take into mind the particular political context. So, as I have just 30 minutes, I can give you just a short overview of empirical data, and I have to reduce. That's why we give you an overview of empirical data collected in Germany and trying to link them, for example, to other countries like in the United Kingdom or in France. Many studies, as well in Germany, as well as in the United Kingdom or in France, have identified some obstacles to integration in sport that can be identified on the individual level. We can see that especially ethnicity accentuates the high participation rates of males and the low participation rates of females. Many surveys show there's no differences between men with migration background and men without migration background. Both are represented in sport clubs at the same level. But we can see an effect of gender and race, ethnicity and religion that are multiplicative and that they are intersectional crossing. Especially Muslim women experience considerable difficulties accessing programs and services that meet their religious requirements and consequently feel systematically constrained in their recreation participation. Because in these studies, they say that they want to do sport, but they do not meet the particular requirements at the sport organizations. The sport organizations, on the other hand, are saying they cannot participate in our sport offers due to their religion or due to their culture. Though we have a big gap between the provider's perception of women's needs and the women's needs of their needs. However, ethnicity or religion is not the only marker or is not the only obstacle to participating in a sport offer. We also can see the impact of the socioeconomic status that is interlinked with racial, age, and ethnicity-related dimension. That we have, sometimes we have kind of triple discrimination processes. So these intersectional effects show, for example, that women and girls with migration background and economically disadvantaged are less integrated in sport offers than men or boys with migration background and also with low socioeconomic background. So, to come to the first conclusion, the idea or our idea of the sport for all is not, and we hope is not yet realized. And probably one explanation could be that the conditions of sport providers do not fit in with individual markers. So we will have now a look on the conditions of sport providers, especially in Germany. But before having a closer look, I will just give you some preliminary remarks about the functioning of sport clubs in Germany. Sport clubs are organizations of people with same interests, though they try to focus on their homogeneous ideas or representations or interests. And actually, many studies about the functioning of sport clubs are showing that this homogeneity of interest and democratic participation structures and the voluntary engagement are the main and also the necessary elements for the stability of a sport club. So now we have the situation that on the one hand, we have particular individual characteristics and needs. For example, the needs of women and girls with Muslim background. And on the other hand, we have the structural characteristics of a sport club, of a sport provider. And now these both are meeting each other. And we have three ways of handling this meeting. The first way could be that the sport club says, okay, you can participate in our sport offers, but you have to adapt to our existing system. That is what I've described before as the assimilationist way of handling this meeting. The second way could be that the individuals are interested in participating in sport offers at a sport club, but they are not willed to adapt to the existing system and they retire. And this way is often described as a self-exclusion, though they are not willed to do it, they exclude themselves, but it could be also a consequence of an assimilationist pressure. The third way of handling this, conflict or this meeting is that both sides could create a third place or a third mode of organization functioning. That means in a kind of integration, looking for compromises. That means a reciprocal process that is based on mutual respect, tolerance, and openness, and in a sense of lived interculturality, being open for the structure, being open for the sport club to change and willing to change. Let's see, what are the conditions or pre-excitements of sport clubs? Are they really open to change? In every 2 years in Germany, there's a big survey about the situation and perspectives of sport clubs. In the year 2015, more than 70,000 sport clubs participated in that online survey. And what we already can see is only about 6% of all sport club members that have been surveyed are migrants. And probably one of the explanations of this low level could be the pursued aims of the sport clubs. The sport clubs are asked, what are your aims and what you want to be, what would you want to represent? And we can see that they want to represent at all, more or least at all level, kinds of aims that are in contradiction. They want to offer a sport to a pro-target group, and at the one hand, they also value traditions, and there's a strong need or interest that the sport club shall not change. And what we can see is there's really an ambivalence of sport providers of being interesting for a broad target group, but at the same time keeping or maintaining traditions. They did not have realized that being interesting for a broad target group means changing, means developing. Though they're in between the two poles of tradition and openness. Although for the other part of quality, a marker in sense of interculturality, how many migrants are represented on the management level or executive level, we can see that on the management level, there are only in 10% or around about 11% of the sport clubs that have been surveyed are persons with migration background. This means 0.16 migrants per club. And as you can see, there are always more men than women with migration backgrounds on the different levels. For the executive level, that means mostly being a coach, you can see that about 14% of the sport clubs have coaches with migration background. That means 0.34 coaches with migration background per club. So in total, there are only 20% of sport clubs having integrated or included persons with migration background, either on the management or executive level. That means a half migrant per club. So Germany has a luxury position, probably, that we have a special program that is financially supported by the Ministry of Inner Affairs and by the Sport Federation in Germany. It's called Integration Through Sports. And these are sport clubs that decided to work on this social work of integration processes. And there have been a big evaluation of these integrations through sport clubs in 2009. Now we can have a look on if these sport clubs are more successful in a sense of interculturality. Are they more successful in integrating persons with migration background in the different levels? What we already can see is that in these particular sport clubs are 86% persons with migration backgrounds, in contrast to 14% without migration background. And just to remember, in the regular sport clubs, more than 70,000 regular sport clubs, are only 6% of members with migration background. Let's see in which different sport activities the migrants participate. You can see that these particular sport clubs offer mostly gymnastics, football, boxing, fitness, and dance. What you can see in the pink is that especially in fitness and dance, there are most female migrants. 46% of all migrants are in fitness and 58% in dance. But now we can see the mostly offered activities in these special sport clubs are combat sport and football. And that's why these particular sport clubs do not succeed either integrate women and girls with migration background. These particular sport clubs succeed also in integrating or in attracting men and boys with migration background. But what we can see is the importance of coaches with migration background, especially for women. You can see that if the coach is female and has migration background, there are 58% of women participating in that sport offer. Whereas if the coach is male and without migration background, there are only 30%. But just to remember, we have only 0.07 female coaches per club in regular sport club. That could be an explanation why the women and girls are not as much represented than men. To conclude, finally, all studies show that sport is not lived integration per se, that there are particular prerequisites are needed. And that's really a decision of sports club if they want to work in such social area. If they want to work in this area, they have to be open to change. This means creating new forms of doing sport together, not forgetting traditions, but developing. Creating an atmosphere for communication processes that are based on mutual respect and tolerance. Orientating sport offers at particular needs and interests, and finally, recruiting persons with migration background at all levels, and for example, working with gatekeepers. And just to think about and to reflect on it, in the idea of inclusion, it is not the individual that has to adapt to the organizational structure, but the organization that has to adapt to the individual needs. Thank you very much for your attention.